Welcome Toni. Toni said she's going to introduce herself.
Jody said, do you want to introduce yourself or do you want me to? I think I'd do a better, no. So I'm Dr. Toni Bisconti. Thank you for having me here. I have never heard of this conference before this year. It seems like it's super cool, way different than the, maybe I shouldn't say this, stuffy conferences that academics have to go to year in and year out. And you already seem like you're having more fun. And I like that when I looked at the agenda, beer was in the agenda like three times. Like it was like, if you're here early, have beer. If you stay for the keynote, have beer after. Go to Jilly's for brunch, you can have beer. So I feel like, yeah, right. It's like three times, so that's fantastic. So I'm going to talk a little bit about navigating dinner topics. So these are typically topics you avoid at the dinner table. And I'm not a particularly good expert at this, as I've argued at the dinner table probably more often than I've not. But I also try to learn from my mistakes and will navigate this the best that I can, no pun intended. I've worked at the University of Akron for about 15 years. I'm from Youngstown, which isn't far from here. For those of you who are somewhat local, I'm about an hour away. I actually have a couple of my Youngstown friends who surprised me today. So it's kind of weird having like sort of academics. I have my friends here. I have my friends from the Falls. I have my wife in the back there. So it's I have glasses on too, so I can't really actually see everyone. I hope I've pointed you all out okay. I'm in the psych department. The classes I teach typically deal with prejudice. I look at kind of queer issues and prejudice towards queer groups of people. I also look at race, I look at ethnicity, I look at religion, but quite honestly, prominently, I look at ageism. That's my area of interest, probably more so than anything else. I grew up in a very age-integrated community, and I never understood why people who were 18 couldn't have friends with people who were 70, and realized as I aged that that was something strange. I also am a queer-identified woman, and growing up in Youngstown with a full-blooded Italian family, Catholic Italian family, that wasn't something that was particularly celebrated. It wasn't something that wasn't celebrated. Like, they have, like, gay family members, but they were sort of like, I don't know, you have to be gay? My mom's first question was like, are you cutting your hair? I'm like... I don't know. And then my dad was like, I think it's the soap operas that made her gay. And I'm like, what? Soap operas? It's just a very confusing time for everyone involved. So, you know, I've had a lot of different experiences being a kind of left-wing, liberal, queer-identified woman in academia from Youngstown, Ohio, in this sort of heart of blue-collar steel industry in which I love very much. My friends and my family there. So, all right. So I'm gonna give you a quick outline. First, we're gonna start with crowd participation because that's what academics do. Maybe it's not, but that's what I do. Then I'm gonna just show you a bunch of documents because, you know, it seems like the thing to do. Then I'm gonna talk about fake news and how you might evaluate sources. Because this is what I've noticed, and I'm sure anyone over the age of 30 has noticed this as well. In the last like 10 years, I have no idea what's true. Like, I read things and I'm like, okay, that seems okay. And I read something else and it's like completely inconsistent with what I read in the first place. And people who are under 30 just read it, just clickbait it, just click on something and they're like, that must be what it is. And there's no evaluation. Then I'm going to talk about my big fat Italian family. And there's a couple of non-Italians in there thrown in because we don't want to be bigoted. Then we're going to talk a little bit about divisive topics, microaggressions, microinterventions. Debriefing and kind of a follow-up from that, coping, and then final thoughts. I have no idea how much I'm going to get through, but we're going to go as fast as we can. All right, so we're going to start with this. So think about your families. Not about your chosen families, but your families, right? Because our families of origin sometimes, you know, our chosen families or our friends are often like-minded. So it's a little bit easier, but with our families of origin or our friends of origin, our high school friends, our college friends, they're not always like-minded, right? So question is, what is the most divisive topic with which your family discusses regularly? What do you feel like just comes up regularly? Anything?
Religion.
Religion? Money.
Male-female power.
Male female power. Well, that's easy. Those other ones are. I feel like my family talks a lot about Black Lives Matter. And we have a lot of police officers in our lives, and so they have a very kind of constant debate about that. Anyone else?
Voting.
So in 1 minute or less, how would you describe the typical conversation with your parents, with your kids, with your siblings, with your whatever?
I'm trying not to converse with my siblings.
Right, you have one. Does he bait you?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
And I used to take the bait, but I don't anymore.
So what do you do when he says something?
I usually walk away.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Same with your nephews, or at least one of them,
yeah.
Right?
Yep.
And that probably makes the time more pleasant for your mother,
yes.
Who you're trying to make sure doesn't see this constant fighting, right? And yours is like political ends of the spectrum. Right, which I think in the last 8 years has been super prominent.
Right.
Like, all of a sudden, politics has become something that you, it was always like, oh, you can't talk about politics. Now it's like, you'll die.
Yeah.
Well, like, there's like literally like, Lindsay will remember this. I got a breast reduction the night after Donald Trump won his presidency. And my mother, who was coming up to quote unquote support me, and my mother is my favorite woman in the world. One of my favorite women in the world, I apologize. But she came up to support me and she was like, do you know who won? And I'm like, I do. And I'm like, 372 stitches. And she's like, oh my God, Donald Trump won. And I'm like, I hate you. I'm already in pain. And she's like, it's fine. It's fine. I'm so excited. And I just couldn't like fight with her because, you know, the boobs. It was super difficult. In my family, I feel like it's usually either me and my sister Lori or me and my dad that argue. And with my dad, he'll ask me a question, and then I'll go to answer it, but he just cuts me off before I answer the question. And there have been times that has turned into a very explosive, loud Italian argument. And then kind of trying to tie this in, what do people use to defend your positions, Lindsay? Yes. Yeah. 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 And your family will use focus on the family too. I feel like there's like a nice little focus on the family type of thing.
Where did you read that?
Yeah.
Did you read that on Facebook?
Right.
Did you read that from your friend's text? No.
Right. And oftentimes they don't know. They don't know where they got the information they got. They just sort of have this information, right? Because print media, print news is pretty obsolete, but now we just see something on Facebook or Twitter or whatever it is, and that's become sort of factual to us. Or it's just been, this is what I've always thought, right? So I've always thought this is the truth, right? So, you know, it's hard to battle that. So, you know, what kinds of documents do we have? We have lots of things. This, I feel like, was the beginning of kind of this new world that we've entered now, right? So the world has changed dramatically because of the coronavirus, because of COVID. And it'll never not be that. We will all have experienced that. And some of the headlines are, you know, this is real, this is what we have to do, there's so many people dying. And some of the other headlines are like, you're all assholes because you think that everyone's dying. And really, you know, this is just some government conspiracy to put like things in, you know, it's just all over the place. I know, isn't that fun? Yeah, I thought that was really cool too. Yeah. We have some Trump stuff. I remember January 6th and being like, what is actually happening? And yet still, there were people that were like, well, I mean, this isn't really trying to overthrow the government. This is just, we didn't like these people anyway. I was like, I don't even know what you're talking about. But again, there's like sources on both sides. You see that again? Yeah, thanks. I know. Yeah. Right, now the sort of Me Too movement was really big, right, several years ago, which again, it's like there's a movement and then there's an opposite movement, right? So there's a movement and then it gets called this sort of witch hunt. Now every man is nervous at all times because there's this witch hunt, right? Black Lives Matter, which has hit sort of our area fairly recently, right, with Jaylen Walker's death, where again, you have this whole movement of Black Lives Matter, and then you have this whole other movement of there's always a reaction and then the re-reaction, right, for everything. And unfortunately, or maybe fortunately, the people in our lives are going to come from vastly different areas, right? Same-sex marriage. Now you have a lot of people who are concerned that's going to be overturned, right? There's people that have sort of these real fears that if that goes back up to the Supreme Court, that's going to be overturned. Cleveland's baseball team, that was just a shit show, right? In fact, Lindsay, you were there. The other night, my brother-in-law's mom died a few days ago, and they were talking about what she likes to do in her spare time. They're going to write it in the obituary. And the question was whether to call them the Cleveland Indians or Cleveland Guardians. There was a vote among all the people there whether they should call it in the newspaper the Cleveland Indians or the, and it was like the most talked about thing at that particular moment was, what do we call it? And they decided on the Indians because that's what she called it. But it had this sort of like conversation of, well, what do we do? Well, we don't want to be disrespectful, but at the same time, like, this is how she knew this team, and this whole like conversation about what to put in the obituary. This happened not too long ago, and I'm actually going to bring this up because we were on a family vacation when this happened, and I'll show you what my family vacation looks like. This was terrifying for a lot of people, for many, many, many people, and there were a lot of very, very emotional reactions in one way or the other. And then in academia, we have to deal with all kinds of things, like, I'm not even allowed to talk about certain things. The classes I teach are about diversity. They're about hate. They're about sexuality. Apparently, though, if people want to find out if I'm secretly trying to brainwash people, they could look for words like equity, diversity, and inclusion, or culture, multicultural competence, any kind of bias, social justice, microaggressions, anti-racism. All of these things are secret brainwashing techniques. It's tough. I am a brainwasher because I teach about all of them, right? And so these things are out there, like on Twitter, like this is out there, like these are the like words to be careful when talking about critical race theory, which is to me terrifying that there's this list of things that are out there that I shouldn't be teaching about because we don't respect my students enough to know what is research, what is opinion, what is their opinion, so on and so forth. Then there's fake news. With my students, I have them evaluate every single source they use for every single paper. And they have to go first, if they're gonna use, now, first of all, if they're gonna use something, it has to be peer reviewed. And in our world, if you're in academia or anything like that, we understand what peer reviewed is. But obviously most people don't even know what peer reviewed means. Like that's not something they think about. So then you got to think about the sources you're getting things from. You know, so like my litmus test is if I think it's unbelievable, it's probably unbelievable. Like a spider as big as the entire side of a house one time was on Facebook. It was like, here's this spider and it is as big as the side of a house. And it was a picture of the spider. It was like in Texas where everything's big. And I was like, holy shit, there's like the spider is like as big as the sun, right? And then you like fact check it on like Snopes or something. You're like, oh, that's false. I was really sad about that one because I was hoping that was true. I don't even know what it was. It wasn't even during a season. It was just a random fake spider that someone, I have no idea, right? It was fake. So you have students do that. Another thing I give my students, and something that I think is important if any of you teach about sort of consuming information, there's a website called All Sides, allsides.com, and it kind of gives you the leanings of different news sources. You know, as someone who's liberal, I often am in the sort of L area. Even though I try to be more moderate, I try to listen to NPR or try to listen to things that are a little bit more in the middle. Obviously, there's some right-leaning publications. There are times that I listen to right-leaning stations to try to figure out what the opposing viewpoint is, to see if there's any, I don't know, anything sort of valid that they're saying, and sometimes there is. I think it's really important for me to broaden my brain in that way. But when you think about what you are receiving in information, it's important to think about where you're getting the information. So there's lots of websites like this. So when Roe v. Wade overturned, I was on a family vacation. Does anyone go on family vacations anymore? No? Yes? Lisa, how many people go with your family when you go?
Just me and my brother, his wife, two kids.
Okay, five. It's a good group.
I just went with 14.
You did, I saw, yeah. And your brother washed the dishes. Yeah, your brother washed the dishes one night. I was really impressed with that. So 14. Anyone travel with a bigger group than 14? This was my family vacation. All in one house. It's an odd thing. Really? Here we all are. We look so happy. Except my dad. He was real mad by then. He was like, why are we still taking... It took us an hour and 45 minutes to take pictures. He was real mad. Like, look how mad he is. My mom doesn't care all that much. She's like giggling next. She's like, it's all right. But he was real mad. Everyone else seems relatively happy, right? These are siblings. These are cousins. So it's my mom and her two siblings and then all of their offsprings. And we are all super, super close. And correct me if I'm wrong, Lindsay, but I don't think we got into one real argument the entire time we were there. We were in the...
Wait, you and me?
No. I mean a family fight. Right. And it was a huge house. I mean, part of this is the privilege of wealth. We were able to get this huge house that had an elevator in it. Isn't that weird? I wrote it because I feel like you should. Just like if you have one, you should ride it. But one of the things that happened was Roe v. Wade was overturned. And when you have 32 people in the same house, you are inevitably going to have people across the entire political spectrum. And certainly we did. Right, I would say probably the majority of the younger people were. That happens, we have to figure out how to get along. Because in this picture are, you know, academics, there's judges, there's pharmacy workers, there's pharmacists, there's electricians, there's business owners, there's hustlers. We are Italian. There's used car salesmen, there's factory workers, there's a six-month-old who just was the joy of everything because she doesn't even know better yet. Right? And you have to figure out how to navigate this entire group of people when something like that comes up. Okay, so divisive topics. I just wanted to tell you that the ADL has, the Anti-Defamation League has a great website that kind of gives you tips on how to navigate every topic. Religion, money, race, sexual orientation, gender, anything like that. They're really like some interesting like starting questions and how to navigate the conversation and kind of how to go through the conversation. I'm not going to go through it, but it is a really good resource that I have used in the past. So one of the things that I think often about is how to prepare to enter into a conversation that might be divisive. And I'm not always really good at that. Everyone here in my life, who've been in my life for longer than a couple of years, knows that I'm not super good at that, trying to get better. But there are some things that you could think about before entering. So the first one is to we want to examine our motivations. So why am I entering this conversation, right? So am I trying to prove a point? Because already that's not the right reason to get into a conversation. Are you trying to educate? It's probably not a good reason to enter the conversation unless someone has said they want to be educated. If you're trying to learn, and give information, okay, then there's some give and take, but you just gotta be honest about your motivations. Oftentimes we wanna blame the other people for not being able to sort of listen when really it's us. We just think that our opinion is better. And so we think, well, we would listen if they would just listen to us, right? Examine your motivations. You have to admit your own biases. This is one of the hardest things I think I've had to do and I continue to do. I do this with my students. I try to do this with my family. I try to do this with my friends. There are things that I have biases about. I don't know where they came from. I probably have good guesses. I continue to try to work on them. I'm 50 now, 49. I think I've done a lot of self-work to work on them, right? But we all have biases. And the person who says they don't, it's hard to talk to that person. Because if you don't want to do self-work, you certainly aren't going to be able to convince someone else to do work, right? You want to ask yourself if it's worth it. So before you enter into anything divisive, is it worth it or not? Because sometimes it's just not. I used to think that I had to be like a champion of social justice issues. I felt like I just had to. Like it was just imperative in me to do that. I no longer feel that way. I feel like if the opportunity arises and I feel like there's an opportunity to have a good dialogue, great. But if it doesn't, or if it's with someone that I just feel like we've had this argument 300 times, we can't leave each other's lives because you're in my family and I'm in yours and we love each other, I'm just not gonna go there. And that's okay. You wanna be aware of power dynamics. So as an instructor, I have to think about this all the time. There may be students that disagree with me, and it's really hard to disagree with me when you're a student, right? I'm the one grading you. So, you know, I talk about things that are super divisive in class. It's really hard probably for a student to say, I don't think gay people should be allowed to get married. That would be a really hard thing, right, for someone to say to my face. And if someone says that to my face, I would appreciate that. And I would try to reward that in a weird kind of way. And I would certainly try to put them at ease from the start. Like, we're not friends. It's okay if you feel X, Y, Z, and whether that's consistent or inconsistent with the way I feel, that's okay, right? But to do that, you have to acknowledge the power dynamics. You have to say, I know that it may be hard for you to put out an opposing viewpoint because I'm the one sort of in charge or grading, and I own that. And we could talk about that. And here are the steps to take if you feel like I'm taking advantage of that. Here's my chairperson's number. Here's my chair loves that. Here's my dean's number. Dean loves that. Here's the provost. Now that I'm the union president, here's Brian Bogato's number. He won't take that too. You know, whatever, right? You give him all the numbers. And I think even that puts him a little bit at ease, that I'm at least saying, like, there are ways to keep me in checks and balance. Okay, so how do we engage in a divisive conversation? I don't know. How do you guys engage?
My dad starts talking.
And then what happens?
I roll my eyes.
Okay. So that would be...
Like, punch me under the table. Like, get into it.
Is that what I do or what your mom does?
What you do.
Yeah.
Mom pretends nothing's happening. She can't hear anything. Do-do. Pass the bread.
Yeah.
And
mm-hmm. And then do you do anything from there?
Depends.
Depends on the environment, depends on what you're talking about, depends on how much time is left, depends on how much your mom is upset that you're going to have this argument. Other people, how do you engage?
Choose words very carefully.
You put food in your mouth? Is that what you said? Yeah, put food. Choose words very carefully. What kind of words are you going to choose?
And that I don't necessarily expect everyone to agree right away.
Yep. I love that you said right away. They better down the road, but right away.
It would be nice.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Also be like, and also to use like what I have been taught about good listening, which is like try to reflect what people say back to them. Be like, what I'm hearing you say is, and then And then that gives them a chance to see what they said sounded like to you and give them a chance to clarify if it didn't match up with what they intended, stuff like that.
Absolutely. Is your name Cy?
Yes.
You could come up now. And you can just do this lecture. That's perfect, right? Yeah, yeah. Those are all the things, right? You use I statements. You try to contextualize it. You try to make it like this is a vulnerability of me. This is my story. This isn't the story, but this is my story. You try to make sure they feel understood. And it's hard to do that. Paula, do you do that with your brother?
No.
No. No understanding, right. It's hard to do because the further apart you are and the more emotional you are, and God forbid you have alcohol at your dinner table, then it like goes downhill from there. One time Lori and I, we had a fight that got so bad, we ended up like throwing these, what were those little stuffed animals from Pokemon called? Pikachus at each other. I don't know what was happening. It was 2 a.m. She's like, you don't believe, we're like screaming. And then we didn't even know what we were fighting about. It was alcohol and Pikachu. That just did us in. Yeah. So first of all, you want to have simple ground rules. Now, when you're in the middle of having a conversation, it's hard to be like, hey, back up. Let's talk about ground rules. Right. But you, your family, your spouses, your children, your siblings, there should always be ground rules, at least in your own mind. Things shouldn't get personal. You shouldn't say you think. You shouldn't say you can't presume to know what someone thinks, feels, does. You make the I statements. You make sure you're talking about it from the first person. You want to listen to understand. If you're already preparing what you're going to say back while the person's talking, you know, you suck. Right? Like you're already, like, you are the one that has to stop. You have to actually listen. Don't try to cut them off. Don't, like, literally sit there and listen, right? Where you're not just listening so you could take your turn next, but you're actually trying to understand what they're saying, even if it's infuriating. And if you can't do this, abandon. Just abandon it. Don't try. If you can't try to understand, then stop. Just say, you know what? I am too emotional to have this conversation. I can't. And make it about you. Don't say you're acting like an asshole, so I'm not gonna talk to you anymore. Like, just make it about yourself. I'm having a hard time doing this. I'm gonna take a step back, right? You wanna ask questions to understand people's point of view. If you don't understand it, ask them. Sometimes what someone says, you know, so we just had a family member say that they wished that their son wouldn't be gay. And they were like, man, I hope my son's not gay. And Lindsay just was like, gone. She just was like, left the room, upset, super upset.
You should be so lucky.
Okay. And I was like, what do you mean? I was the superior person right then, just so you know. And he was like, it would be so hard for him. Like, I don't know what he would do. That is what he said first. I am not going to... No, I didn't coach him. And that's what he meant. And we talked through that, and he said in this area it would be really difficult, and he would have a hard time with it, but he would try not to have a hard time with it. He just wants to love him. But it would be hard. But again, if you cut them off right at the start, you're never going to even get to that slight gray area. You want to find commonalities. This is hard. This is hard when you have people in your life that you feel really strongly opposed to politically or religiously or lifestyle or whatever it is. But you do have commonalities. With my family, our commonality may be as simple as we're Italian. We're brought up Catholic. We're from the same super small town. We like the same food for the most part, I guess. We love the same restaurants. We all like bocce. We all, you know, there's just these, like, you have to, right? So, like, those are the things. We just like them. And those are the, and we all love the kids. Whatever kids there are, that's all we have to talk about is just the kids. And if that's all we talk about, that's it. That's all we talk about, right? Because there are commonalities between us. You want to use I statements, like Cy said, right? You want to make sure you're talking in the first person. I used to make a lot of you statements. Like, I used to make a lot of statements like, you don't understand. You don't get this. How can you not see this? How can you not get, like, those sorts of things instead of, like, man, I hurt when you say that. Like, it hurts me that you say that. I feel blah, blah, blah. It's harder to argue against someone who's going to talk about themselves, right? You want to seek and share stories, but you don't want to story top. Wow, there's a lot of disgruntled comments there, a little, right? And I'm probably a famous story topper too, so I apologize in advance for that if you're going drinking with me later. But story topping is not something that you can use to relate to people. Someone says they've been through something super difficult, and you say, well, you think that was bad. You should have tried being gay in the 80s, right? And all of a sudden, you're, you know, that just completely quieted down this person's experience. So again, we have to be careful doing that, right? Don't gaslight, don't bait, hard to do, and don't take the bait. Don't take the gaslight, you know, like, no, it's happening, right? All of us are adults here. We could tell when someone's gaslighting us, or we could tell when someone's baiting us. And if we're not sure, we could still remove ourselves, right? Because if there's some ambiguity, it's probably good to remove yourself. Pay attention to your body eye rolls. Pay attention to your huffs. Pay attention to the eye rolls. Pay attention to your closed body kind of, you know, like you could tell when I'm no longer listening to someone. I'm looking the other direction. I don't even hear them. And that alone is going to gaslight someone, is going to bait them, because you've already completely shut down. If you're going to shut down, just don't have the conversation. Again, walk away from it. All right, how do you de-escalate? Well, one, you don't interrupt. Probably the first and foremost biggest thing is you don't interrupt. Two, you reflect the speaker's words back to them. You make sure that they understand that you're at least attempting to understand. And don't reflect it back to them like in this super negative way. Like, okay, well, what you really said was, you basically hate all gay people. And you're like, okay, that isn't what I said at all, right? You want to reflect to them the way that they intended it. You want to let them express their frustration. If they're mad, if they're frustrated, let them get it out. Don't ever tell a woman to calm down. In every, like, capacity, right? Like, I feel like in every way. And similarly, I'm not sure I would tell a guy to calm down. And similarly, I wouldn't tell someone who is non-binary to calm down. I think calm down in and of itself is probably like baiting. Because if someone is pissed off enough for you to say calm down, they're not going to listen to you. Think that's going to work, right? So you want to let them be able to experience the frustration that they're experiencing. If it gets too much for you, you could walk away and be like, I am so sorry that this upset you so much. I'm gonna walk away from this, but let them do them. You do you. You wanna maintain eye contact. You wanna have nonverbal cues that are positive. You wanna make sure that people feel as though you're listening, you're there, all of those good things. You wanna nod to communicate you understand. You wanna express empathy. Empathy is something I talk a lot about, I've learned a lot about. I was trained as a developmental psychologist, so learning about empathy is something we started super early in grad school. You know, empathy is one of those things that for some of us it comes really naturally, and for others of us it doesn't. And even if it doesn't, you could still express it. You could still attempt it. You could still say, I don't know exactly how that would feel. I've never been through that, but man, that sounds like it sucks. Like, that enough is meaningful, right? Is to try to get to where they're at. You want to recommend revisiting the topic at a different time or maybe a different mode. If it's too emotional and you really feel like, so Lori's my sister and we are really, really, really close. And I wouldn't say we're on complete ends of the spectrum politically, but we're on pretty different ends of the spectrum politically. And Trump being elected, I thought was like gonna end us. Like, I just thought we were just gonna not, I don't know, it was really hard for us because we're used to being on the same page with most things and it was just really hard. And so one of the things we started doing was writing each other. So we would see an article and instead of like trying to like talk when both of us are kind of hot-headed Italian, you know, we've known each other our whole lives and we say mean things if we want to say mean things, this was a way to sort of dispassionately like put out like, okay, this is an article I saw. This is what upset me about Trump saying this or doing this. What are your thoughts on it? Or how, you know, and then she, and it was, it worked for us. All right. Do you guys know what microaggressions are? Have you heard of microaggressions?
Yeah.
What are microaggressions? Tony, what are microaggressions?
They are small things that don't actually seem like much unless you actually point them out, that nonetheless really marginalize or are purposely intended to, not necessarily purposely, but cause, have the effect
right.
of the
right.
definition on the screen. Yeah.
Right. And that's what's hard, right? They're brief, they're quick.
Yeah.
They're like so slight that you're like, was that intended? Like, did that person say that? And sometimes they're intentional. And like you said, other times they're not. So sometimes the speaker doesn't even realize that what they did is a microaggression, even though it affects us in that same kind of painful way, right? So it's those things that for racial minorities, sexual minorities, you experience all the time. It's almost like I don't even notice them sometimes, because it's just, if I had to notice it every time, I don't know that I would like leave my house, right? Like it's like it just all the time, right? And there's three different types. There's micro assaults, micro invalidations, and micro insults. I'm not going to talk a lot about the micro assaults because they're actually big. They're like pretty recognizable. Someone calls me a derogatory name for being gay, I'm like, oh, that was a micro assault. Yay, we all know that, right? So it's different than that. It's the smaller ones, the invalidations or the insults. And the reason I kind of bring this up during this talk is sometimes when we are having these kind of divisive conversations, we not only receive microaggressions, but we are giving microaggressions. And I want to make sure that we're clear that you don't have to intend to be an asshole to be an asshole. And even if you didn't intend to, you need to own it if someone points out that you were. Like, it's not a good enough excuse to just be like, well, I didn't mean that. Like, that's not good enough, right? Like if you didn't mean to hit someone with your car, but you still did, you can't just tell the judge, well, I didn't mean to, and everything's fine, right? Like, you still did injury, even if the intent wasn't there, right? Okay, so micro assaults. So this microaggressions were first, this kind of theory kind of came about looking at racial minorities, specifically Asian American racial minorities, and the slights that they experience in the U.S., which are very different than perhaps what like African Americans experience, what Latinos experience, because Asian Americans have this reputation of being like the model American, like they're not gonna protest, like they're nice, except we don't really think they're American, so we're gonna ask them where they're from constantly. And it's like that, like where are you from to someone that is clearly from Akron is the micro insult. Right, so this is where the paradigm kind of started. And I'm not gonna talk about the original research, I'm just trying to contextualize it. So micro assaults are explicit racial denigrations, verbal, nonverbal attacks meant to hurt the intended victim. So this is pretty much intentional. The other two, invalidations are verbal comments or behaviors that exclude, they negate, they nullify people's experiences. You know, it's things like, oh, come on, like, don't worry about that. Just let that roll off. They didn't mean anything by it. It's like just trying to invalidate. And you may be well-intentioned. Like, you may literally be like, you know, I mean, they didn't mean anything by it. There was a time period that the phrase, that's so gay, was like out of everyone's mouth, like constantly. I didn't even know what it meant. Like, I was like, the car is gay? Like, do they sleep with other blue cars? Like, I don't know what you're talking about. Like, is there an attraction? They'd be like, my professor is so gay. And I'm like, are they gay? And they're like, no, stupid. And I'm like, what? Why can't we say stupid instead of gay? Like, I don't know what you're talking about. Or like, they'll say it like on an inanimate object. Like, oh my God, that walk was so gay. Was it? How was a walk gay? Did you, anyway. So things like that, that they may not intend to be, but it's hurtful nonetheless. Then there's these insults. These are behavioral, verbal remarks that convey rudeness, insensitivity. They may demean a person's racial heritage. So again, I have a friend, a good friend who's Vietnamese. His name's Anthony here in the U.S. And he was actually born in Southern California. He has a Vietnamese name, but he also has his American name, and it was Anthony. So, his parents were from Vietnam, but they came to the U.S. relatively young as well. Like, I want to say maybe late teens, his grandparents brought them over, right? And so we go to conferences together. He's another kind of psychologist person, and no matter where we would go, and he may be one of the smartest academics I've ever known. So if any of you are in psychology, he took over for Bronfenbrenner. So if any of you have heard of Yuri Bronfenbrenner, he's a big psychologist. Anthony took over at Cornell for that person. Like, he is big time smart guy. So we go, we drink, we do stupid things, and a waitress will come over, and every time they'll start talking like slow and loud to Anthony. Oh my God. And Anthony, because he's kind of a dick, is so he'll just start talking in Vietnamese, but he doesn't know Vietnamese. So he just starts talking in random, like he's saying food, I think. I don't even know what he's saying, but he's like talking like that back to this waitress, who then is like really like talking louder and like slower and like using like, you know, and then finally Anthony's like, I'm from fucking Southern California. Like, why did you, you know? And then she's like, well, were you really, really, really? And he's like, I'm from Southern California. And he's speaking like me. And she's like, but where are you really from? And he's like, Southern Cal, you know. And so now he's the one that's speaking slow and loud to this waitress in this dynamic that is like so painful to experience. And obviously he's experienced it so much that he's learned to deal with it in his own kind of levity, which I'm sure when he first experienced it was not that way, right? But those are those kind of microaggressions. Okay, so the thing about microaggressions, and as Toni actually already said, these are these things that, you know, we start saying to ourselves, like, did I hear that right? Right? Should I say something? They're those things that you're just not sure. It's easy if you hear someone be super derogatory towards someone, it's easy to go to them and be like, back off. But if you're not positive that it's because that person is Latino, Black, gay, whatever it is, then it's hard to do that, right? It's hard to kind of confront someone when they have deniability, right? And so microaggressions, and so, you know, it's something that I want you to pay attention to too, because we often are the people who are doing the microaggressions. They're not beneath any of us. So we just gotta kind of keep our, and sometimes we do it to people that we think deserve it. So, you know, we'll do it to the opposite end of the spectrum to us. So the people that we think are right-wing conservatives, that we think are this kind of way, we make assumptions about them and experience or throw out microaggressions towards them, which is just as bad, maybe a little less bad, but just as bad as experiencing them yourself, right? Okay, so how do we identify them? So the first thing is you have to recognize the situation. You have to recognize your feelings, your thoughts. If you feel some sort of way, you're probably experiencing a microaggression. Even if you can't label what it was, you have to validate it, because it's important to just validate it to yourself. Even if you end up not saying anything, you end up not confronting the person, it's just important to say, all right, you know what? This hurt me. That must have been a microaggression. You want to consider the reasons for the feelings and thoughts. So you want to kind of think through it. This is such a stupid example, but I use it every time and I don't know why. And I'm thinking this is going to be on this video and my family's going to hear it, but whatever. So, you know, I'm from this town. It's really small. It's like 800 people. And I graduated with 24 people. It's public school. It's strange. We're very strange. Super small. There's only 30 people that graduate a year. It's been like that forever. It's an Italian, kind of Catholic, tight-knit group. And I'm really involved still with the community and with the school. My nieces and nephews all went there. I hope their kids go there. My parents went there. My grandparents moved straight from Italy. They went to school there. Incidentally, they got kicked out in 10th grade together, but whatever. And they were both named Tony. My grandfathers both got kicked out, named Tony. I was destined for I don't know what. So everyone went there. And for like the 10, 15 years after I graduated, I was never asked back to be the commencement speaker. I was really upset about it. I give money. I'm supportive of the band. I'm supportive of sports. I was in all the sports. I was in band. I know the band director, my best friend. What do I have to do to be the commencement speaker? There was a, one year, it was like a log. Remember the log person? The log salesman alumni, we were like, what? A log? I got a PhD from Notre Dame. This shit is good. Like, right? So I'm like super upset. So I like would complain about it every year. And my mom one year, I was like, and she's like, I can't believe they didn't ask you. I'm like, I know. I'm like, it's definitely because I'm gay. And she was like, do you think? And I'm like, absolutely. Like, it's an old school, I mean, like, it's an old school Italian guy who's like the principal and superintendent. Absolutely because I'm gay. And she's like, it could be. Yes, Tony Lynn, it could be. Or I don't know. But sometimes you do like get really drunk and like smoke a lot of cigarettes and dance on top of bars and people like throw money at you in the community and then it's like on Facebook for everyone to see. And I'm like, huh, what do you mean? I don't, what are you trying to say? And she's like, I don't know. It just may be like a role model thing and not so much that you're gay. And I'm like it like blew my mind. I'm like, oh my God, it's the bar dancing. Oh my God. Huh. Anyway, yeah. Okay. So, you know, we couldn't confront them because they would have been like, it's the bar dancing. And then what would I have said, right? All right, decide whether you want to have the capacity to respond with microaggressions. You have to make that decision. It's even harder than with actual aggressive behavior to make that decision. Confide, seek validation in close friends, professionals. When you experience microaggressions, it's incredibly important to have a social network. It's incredibly important for you to feel as though someone is there that gets it, that could be like, you know what? I get it. It sucked and I get it. All right, tactics. There's four tactics that we generally go over with interventions because of microaggressions. It's basically making the invisible visible, so making sure you name it what it is. It's disarming the macroaggression or microaggression, saying, this is what I've experienced with this. I think that's what you did. I think that's what I felt. Maybe that's what I did. You want to educate the offender, but be careful. Right? You don't want to preach to them. You want to make sure that you are speaking to them where they want to be spoken to, if they want to be spoken to. So, you know, when people used to say that's so gay, and certainly they didn't mean it as derogatory towards me, I'd be like, that hurts me when you say that. Maybe I'm being sensitive, but that really just, I don't know, that hurts me when you say that. And there's not a lot that someone could say back to that. It's different than being like, fucking stop saying that. And then someone comes back at you like you're the word police, right? But it's, if you have like a genuine, like, it's a little harder. So that's what I try to do. And then you want to seek external intervention. Talk to other people. Get people involved if you feel like there's a systemic microaggression going on. Now, I could talk about these all in more detail, but I'm not because I'm running late. But look, detail. Look, detail. Red. Look, detail. Red. Look. Detail, red. Did you learn? Did you get it?
Yeah.
All in. I figured. Okay. Toolbox. The micro-intervention toolbox. You want to challenge the stereotype. Challenge it in you. Challenge it in them. Be better than the stereotype. Ask for clarification. If you want to know why you weren't the commencement speaker, ask. Why haven't you? And they're going to be like, well, because you dance on bars. And then you're like, all right, no, I'm going to change that for 3 years for sure. And then maybe. Name and make the metacommunication explicit. If you feel as though something is happening and you're like, I think this is what's happening. I think this is what you're saying. I think this is what you're meaning. Say it out loud. Give them the opportunity to say, no, I didn't mean that at all. This is what I meant. Or give them the opportunity to say, yeah, I think I am meaning that. Why is that a problem? And for you to say that's a problem because I'm tired of telling you my pronoun, right? So that's a problem because I'm tired of this, right? Differentiate between intent and impact. You could make sure the person knows, I know you may not have intended this, but that doesn't mean it didn't hurt me. So you could let them off the hook with the, I know this isn't what you meant. Like, I get that. And that means something to me. But it has to mean something to you that it still hurt me. Me, right? All right. So considerations when you're intervening. You want to think about your safety at all times, particularly if you're intervening in a situation that you aren't part of. You see something happening and you want to intervene. What is that going to do for you to intervene? Are you safe to be able to do that, right? What is your mental health to be able to do that? When I was younger, I don't think I could have intervened as much as I could now, because now when I intervene, I don't care if you listen, I don't care if you don't. When I was younger, I felt like my whole identity depended on the intervention. Like if I didn't convince you that what you were doing was wrong or unjust, I felt like, I don't know, like I failed, right? Whereas now I feel like I've said what I needed to say. I hope you get it. If you don't, okay, you don't get it. Acknowledge your own limits. Always seek support. All right, after a conversation. So sometimes you have these difficult conversations and they end badly and it's awkward and you don't know kind of then what to do. I always try to say, try to basically be nicer to the other person at the end. So say, I knew coming to talk to you was good. Thank you for your input. Even if you're thinking, it wasn't. That was useless. That was horrible. But if you want to have another conversation, if this person's in your life, it's one thing when you could just get rid of a person, right? This isn't someone in your life. This is someone you just have a passing conversation with. When it's someone in your life, you want to make sure that they feel validated because this is going to happen again. I hope that we can continue to meet on a regular basis. This meeting was helpful if it's professional, or I hope we could chat about this again. It was really hard to do that today, but I'm really glad we did it. You know that I count on you for guidance. I appreciate you helping me. You know, so like with my dad, I've been like, you know, I come to you. I come to you because I think you're smart. I think you're, I mean, I've not said that a ton, but he is really smart. And there are times that I go to him, maybe not about politics, but I do go to him. And so if we're going to have a big fight, I want to end that with like, I still respect you. Like, I still want to go to you. I'm definitely like that with Lori. I see your point, but I appreciate just kind of you continue talking to me about this. And just more of the understanding. I understand, I share your frustration, I think we've made some progress, you know, whatever it is. You made some excellent points today, and I'll be processing. I don't know who talks like this. Clearly, I got this from the internet, because I would never say that in my entire life. But you could say something like, you know what? This was good. We had a good talk. Let's have a beer. Let's watch something. Let's debrief. Let's just, like, step away from it. All right. Coping. One thing I want to say about coping, sometimes we have a divisive conversation and all of a sudden the coping of it, it's like we don't know what to do. And there's two ways to cope with the situation. There's emotion focused and problem focused. Problem focused coping is when you could change the problem, right? So you know that you could change the problem. I'm upset about something, I could change that problem, I can get out of this relationship, or I could move from this neighbor who's driving me crazy, or I could switch classes because I hate this profession. That's something you could do. Emotion focused is, I can't get out of this. Like, this isn't going to change. I can't do anything about this situation. That's when you have to focus on you. And with divisive conversations, you have to focus on you. You can't control their emotions. You can only control your emotions. So you have to focus on how do you be your best self? How do you not be, you know, I have lots of versions of myself. I have a best self and I have a not. So best self. And how do I not be the not so best self when I have these arguments or when I have these conversations, right? And that's emotion focused. All right, just a couple final thoughts. One, it's okay not to discuss certain things. And again, this is something I feel like I've learned across time. I feel like when I was younger, I wanted to engage in every conversation under the sun. And now I'm like, you know what, it's okay. I understand the value of talking about the weather. I really do. It's a really okay topic to do that, right? Know your audience, know who you're talking to, know what's gonna fall on deaf ears, know who you think you can make an impact with, and who you think could make an impact on you. Balance assertiveness with your own sanity. Of course, we all want to be assertive. I am by nature an assertive person. I am not afraid of conflict. It doesn't bother me in any way. But sometimes I just feel like I'm banging my head against a wall with people, with certain people. And I don't need that. Like, it's okay. You don't have to be the word police. I'm often called the word police. That had to be you, Paula. Was it Nicole? Lindsay! It's so annoying.
I thought so, but I didn't know
that. Yeah, yeah. She has no... Right. Are you the word police? Yeah, I think it's a good thing to be. Okay, that's good. Yeah, did you just learn it right now? Well, apparently I am too, so... Yeah. You don't have to be social justice warriors 24/7. It's okay to take that hat off once in a while, at least in the privacy of your own home. Don't engage with people who won't abide by the ground rules or don't care to change or grow. But honestly, if you only take one thing away, don't engage with people when you won't abide by the ground rules or when you don't want to change or grow. Because if you're just going into a situation to change them, you're going to fail. And it's going to hurt you, and it's not right to them or to yourself. So really, if nothing else, through the 30 slides of a ton of words and as fast as I just spoke, if nothing else, just keep yourself in check. If you want to enter into a divisive conversation, enter into it. But if you're doing it to be right, then that's not fair to the people you're talking to. If you're doing it to kind of understand something a little differently, great. Maybe that solidifies what you're thinking. Maybe it changes what you're thinking. Either way, that's fine. It's better to be understood, I think, for me personally, than it is to be right. Although, being both is fantastic. So, that's it. I don't think I really left time for questions, but certainly if anyone has any questions. Anyone?
I have a comment.
Thank you.
Toni, this is the other Brian in my life, Brian O'Connor.
Hi, Brian O'Connor.
Brian was my advisor in grad school.
Great.
And I would just like to tell you that Brian and I are elated that you dropped so many F-bombs.
Ah, you're welcome. Have you? Have
yes,
you?
Yes,
are those smart people that drop F? I heard swearing smart. Does it? Yeah, that's why I do it. Yeah, yeah. For sure.
We've been for years talking about bad words.
Yes.
In the academic
sphere. Yeah. Yeah. I. That's honestly the biggest reason I didn't teach any other grade. I had to go into college because of the F word.
Right. Alternative. She told Cole is never to put the replacement in because it's the same word.
It is the same word.
It is the same word.
Then why did you use it?
Yeah.
I don't know. I honestly.
I'm really glad you said it.
Thank you.
My child is beside you.
No. I think Molly knows. I think Molly definitely knows. Well, I'm glad I could please you, Brian. Other Brian.
Nice to hear you.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So I just have noticed that now everything is a divisive conversation. So this morning I was leaving the house and I was like, shower is leaking, and my partner Josh was like, yeah, it doesn't matter, all of a sudden it was like, this is a divisive issue in our household, and I'm like, this is like a point of fact, the shower is leaking, do I mean we need to fix it right now? No, but it seems like everybody's amped up. It's not just, it's within our households, it's within our families, and so people feel like attacked from all sides, even if it's I'm like, this is not an issue to argue about.
Yeah,
I
think that's a really good point, and I think you're absolutely right. I think we are our cortisol levels are so super high at all times. That's a little nod to Ray, but our cortisol levels are so high all the time that he's probably reading that, or she's, I think you said, John, he's probably reading that as, you want me to fix this? And that you're being passive aggressive, right? Because we assume passive aggressiveness in everyone. We don't assume, you're just a point of fact. Sometimes I'll tell somebody something just so it reminds me, okay, we need to talk about this later. But it does get perceived. And so, one of the ways you could head that off, although I think it's over-explaining, but one of the ways is to say, I know we're not going to do anything about this right now, but just wanted to let you know so we could talk about it later, blah.
Yeah.
Or to have the conversation at some point when there's nothing divisive happening and saying, it just seems like things are tense. So I just want to, when I put things out, is it like making you feel some sort of way? Like I'm making a, but I think you're right. I think it's like that. It's like that with students. It's like that interpersonally. It's like that. And it's, I don't know. I feel like the whole, I don't know if any of you watch Stranger Things, right? But if you watch Stranger Things, everything is in the upside down. Like, it's just like this whole different world now where we woke up in the year that will not be named, where I got my breast reduction. and it was divisive. And everything, it just got worse and worse and worse. And no matter where you fell on that spectrum, I'm not saying it's we're any better than the, you know, or anything like that, but I think you're right. And I think it makes communication doubly, triply hard. Yeah. Anyone going to drink? You three are okay.
The gallery over there.
Yeah. Apparently my peeps are here to drink. They just had to do this first in order to be able to do that. All right, well, thank you. If anyone needs to get a hold of me for anything, get a hold of one of these people. Jody is fine. Thank you. Thank you.